Va bene? Sì. All right. So, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Sandro Scandolo. I'm representing the director of the ICTP, Attista Bolcar, who is not in town today. So, welcome everybody to this ceremony for the 2020 ICO ICTP Galieno Denardo Award, which takes place, of course, during the traditional Winter College on Optics. It's really a pleasure to see so many known faces and also unknown faces. This is one of the flagship events of the year, the Winter College on Optics. It's been taking place for many, many years. We tried to remember for how many years with Joe the other day, but it's difficult to count them, actually, because it took different names throughout the history of the ICP. It's definitely many, 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 many years. Now, I just wanted to remind particularly the younger members of the audience who Galieno Denardo was. He's been a colleague of mine for just a few years because I arrived here in 2002, and he passed away, unfortunately, in 2007. But Galieno was associated with ICTP essentially from the beginning. He was a professor at the university, and it was actually his specialty was relativity. But he immediately realized that optics could be the tool to somehow, you know, train researchers in developing countries in a field that could have also applications to real problems as opposed to relativity, perhaps one should say. He was, of course, instrumental in a number of programs and activities here at the ICTP. He was even appointed acting administrative director for a year. He was running the optics and lasers activities, the lab, the award, of course. He was in charge of the STEP program and even received an SPI Educator Award while he was here at the ICTP for his efforts in promoting optics in developing countries. A few years ago, I think after he passed away, the decision was taken to name the ICO ICTP prize after Galieno, and I'm really honored. We're really honored about this. I'm not sure I'm supposed to disclose the name of the winner, even though I guess you've saw the posters everywhere. So this is not, don't want to be to spoil you. But I would like instead to invite Joe here on the podium because there are a number of things that are going to happen before we move on with the actual ceremony of the ICO ICTP award. So, thank you.
Okay, oh, there it goes. All right, so before we get to that, before we get to that, we're going to do some internal awards for the activity, for the one you guys are attending. And so we have poster prizes and we have talk prizes. I can say every time I do this, it's always the same story. There's too many good posters, too many good talks. It really is it's really difficult for us. And you know that because you were also doing this. So I'm going to ask, we're going to go posters first and then talks second. We'll do it that order. And so the posters are sponsored, poster prizes are sponsored by SPIE, the International Society for Optics and Photonics. And we have a number of representatives here, including, I'm going to give you last, Maria Uzel. Kent Rockford is somewhere back in the back. That's the CEO of SPI. Go ahead and go talk to him. Maria Uzel, past president. And Crescinda, and then finally, but not because it's least, because she is going to present these awards to the poster prize. So Katarina Sponberg, past president, SPIE. So let me invite Katarina to come up.
Thank you so much. It's really an honor to be standing here. And I have done this a few times, many times I would say, and every year I realize how fortunate you all are who are here. You have been chosen for this Winter College and you have learned a lot. You have, I hope, made a lot of networking networking that may play a role, a very important role in your future progress as scientists, or whatever you end up with as your future goal. You have also all presented very nice posters, and I have been given some nice certificates here. I also have some more substantial benefits here for you. And of course, everyone should have a prize, but that's not how the world works. Prizes are given to certain people, means that you have fulfilled some of the prerequisites. I would say that most of you, of course, of all of you, have presented very interesting results, and we are very happy for that. As we heard, I am a representative of SPIE, the International Society for Optics and Photonics, and SPIE is one of the supporting organizations or learned societies for this Winter College. Okay, so we move to the poster award ceremony now. And usually we start from the third place. There are three places and two at each one. So I have six awards to give out here. And when I call the names, you come up here, you are presented the certificate, and they also would like to take some photo of you. Okay, so we start with a third place award to Silvia Fernanda Cardenas López. And the title of your poster is Collective Effects in the Interaction of Rydberg Atoms with Light. Rydberg was a professor at my university, and my husband has the same chair after him, but there were some persons in between. Okay, so this is Sylvia's certificate here, so take that with honor. No, you stay here. Yes. Okay. I also would like to give you the more substantial part of it, but then you keep up this one. There you go. Okay. Yeah, while you're... You can stay for it. And the second, third place winner is Serhii Derenko. And he has a very complicated title of his poster. It goes along the lines of photoconductivity of stained something. Thin films on a GeSiO01 substrate. Was that correct?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. They can leave?
Yeah.
Okay. So we move to the second place, and we start with Andrea Restori. And the title is Automation of a Pump Probe Experiment. So, no. Your name is?
Andrea Restori.
Your name is Andrea Restori?
Yeah.
So this is not correct?
No.
Okay.
That's okay. The names are right.
Yeah. The names are right. And the money is right. So, okay, we can change that. Okay, so congratulations,
thank
Andrea.
You very much.
Okay.
Thank you.
You can stay up. And the next second place is to Nara Rubiano da Silva. Do I dare to read the theme? It is for the poster, we hope, entitled Investigation Thermodynamics of Entangled Photons Under Turbulence. Okay, correct. And last but not least, the first place. And I read the first name here, Kanin Angus Skunsiri. And the name of the poster, I hope you recognize this, Random Number Generation from Quantum Tunneling Diodes. Okay, wonderful.
Thank you very much.
Fellow here. The last one I have here is for Pega Darveje. And we read here polarization effects in dielectric optical fibers, vector mode matching. Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Coming up next, also to read the, so we have the oral presentations, which everybody was a great sport to do this because just for the people that weren't here, anybody presenting a poster and also some extra participants who did not have a poster had the opportunity to give a 3-minute presentation up here to promote their work. No slides were allowed, so they just have to use their arms, hands, gestures, and try not to pace. All right, and you did a great job. So these prizes will be are sponsored by the Optical Society, and we have two representatives. We have from OSA Europe, we have Klaus Rohl, somewhere right there, Klaus, and from the U.S., the past president of OSA, and a longtime friend of ICDP, we have Anthony Johnson, and Anthony Johnson will present the awards, and hopefully the right titles.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. It gives me great pleasure to be here once again. I have a really long association with ICTP. My first time here was in 1988, believe it or not, and I've been involved in the winter schools since the early 90s. And so it's quite a pleasure to come here and also to see how this room has progressed over the decades as well. I'm here to present five awards for the oral presentations, and I have two third-place winners, two second-place winners, and one first place winner. And let me start with the third place award to Cespedes Paula on the description of composite bosons in discrete toy models. Okay. Yeah, with the other third place winner. The second third place winner is Da Silva Haitor for the talk. Entitled Graded Index Optical Fiber Emulator of an Interacting Three-Atom System, Illumination Control of Particle Statistics and Classical Non-Separability. For second place, the first award is to Akinpilu Akinwumi. Hope I'm pronouncing that right. And the title is An Iron Beam Surface Sputtering Approach to the Quest for Lead-Free Perovskite for Solar Cells. The next prize goes to Wu Qianjiwan. And the title of the talk, Non-Equilibrium Thermodynamics with TQD Protocol, the Role of Initial State Preparation. Congratulations again. And the first place winner goes to Kaur Ravneet. And the title of her talk, Stimulated Raman Scattering of a Gaussian Laser Beam in Preformed Plasma Channel.
Congratulations. We wanted to give everybody a prize, we really did. I'm serious. Okay, now I'm going to hand over the floor to two people. You know Sandro Scandalo, so he's going to come back up representing ICDP, and Roberto Rimponi, president of the International Commission for Optics, and they're going to discuss the prize and do the prize ceremony.
Microphone here. Okay. All right, so we are getting to the second part of the ceremony, which is about the ICO-ICTP Galileo De Nardo Award. Let me just remind you that the award honors young researchers in optics and photonics, And it's a collaboration between the ICO, the International Commission for Optics, in fact represented here by Roberta, and the ICTP. And we established the prize together in 2000. As I said before, in 2007, we was agreed to dedicate the award to the memory and legacy of the late Professor DeNardo, who greatly contributed to the development of optics research within ICTP and in developing countries. The prize has recognized many researchers under 40 from developing countries doing distinguished and important work in optics and photonics. Before I leave the floor to Roberta for the announcement of the winner, I'd like to also welcome all those who are actually following the ceremony through the online streaming. The ceremony is actually live stream on YouTube and Facebook. So you're all there's much more audience than you see here in the room. So now I kindly ask Roberta to proceed with this, with the announcement of the winner.
So the winner of the ICO-ICTP Galieno DeNardo Prize for 2020 is Kok Sing Lim, and he got the prize, the award from, he's actually working at the Photonics Research Center, University of Malaya in Malaysia, and the award is given for his achievements in the field of optical fiber sensing and optical communications, and his substantial contributions to sustainable development in Malaysia through promoting the use of optics-based technologies in the industrial sector. So I would also like to thank the prize committee that is chaired by Murad Sgal, and we have Ialor, the rest of the committee, Anna Consortini, Amadou Vag, and Milcho Danailov and Joni Mela. And they did really a very good work. The candidates this year were very, very good, but Kim was by far the best of all, Kok was by far the best of all, and we are very, very happy to welcome him for his lecture. That will be few mode fiber components for mode conversion in spatial division multiplexing. Yes. So before the talk, congratulations. Before the talk, we would like to present you the certificate and the prize, and of course, have the pictures all together. So, the stage is yours.
Testing?
Yeah.
All right. So yeah, good evening everyone. Yeah, it's a great privilege to be here. So this is my first time here in ICTP. Most of my colleagues has been here before. In fact, some of them, I wrote them the recommendations to be here. So I always try to look for the opportunity to come here. Yeah, took me a few years until Prof. Nimela sent me an email about my award. I'm very grateful. First of all, I would like to express my gratitude to ICO and also ICTP, the selections committee, for the award. So it's a great privilege and recognition for my work. And also, I would like to thank my nominator, Prof. Imrana. To be frank, I wasn't sure I'm supposed to disclose that, but anyway, I'll go ahead and do it. Thank you very much. I cannot thank you enough. And I'm going to talk about my topic. Before I start, I would like to just briefly introduce about where I'm from. Yeah, Photonic Research Center. So it's actually one of the higher institute center of excellence in Malaysia. So it's funded, partially funded by Ministry of Education Malaysia, based in University of Malaya. So I also attach a map, just in case you're wondering where Malaysia is. All right, so it's actually located in one of the countries in Southeast Asia, next to Thailand and also Singapore, and also one of the longest streets in the world, Malacca Street. And it is also a country where I was born and bred, just in case you're wondering about that too. All right, and And this is my lab. So I started working in this lab in 2015 as a senior lecturer. So I took over the lab from my colleague, who was actually too busy to handle several labs at our center. So essentially, it was a fiber backgrading lab. And over the years, I managed to secure some funding and also support from my directors to upgrade. And so we managed to procure some other equipments so that we no longer just work on fiber backgradings, but also some other system, for example, the optical fiber interferometer, which is actually meant for optical sensing, optical instrument, measurement instruments, signal processing, both for optical spectrum and also digital signal processing, optical components for communication system, which is actually one of our niche focus area of our research center. All right. I wasn't sure what's the right topic to talk about today, but considering the title of the Windows College, which is quantum information and communication, so that's the keyword, communication. So I picked the topic, field fiber component for mode conversions in space division multiplexing. All right. So this is the outline, space division multiplexing, followed by the mode conversions. Apparently, there are many mode converters available in the market now, and both in commercially available and also lab prototypes. I'll be focusing on field mode FBG, fiber backgradings, and then the summary and my other research interests. So this is the trend of the development in the capacity of fiber over the years since 1980s. The very first optical telecommunication system was installed in Chicago, 1977. So it was a 1.5 miles optical fiber system, fiber pair, that can accommodate 672 voice channel. So it is not written in the literature, but more, very likely it's actually based on time division multiplexing. So time division multiplexing has limitations, limited by the EOM, the modulator itself. The maximum you can go at the time probably is just 10 gigabit per second, the maximum. Of course, now we have 40 gigabit per second. So what happens later on, they realize that it is not efficient. Optical fiber can offer more. So that's when WDM comes in, wavelength division multiplexing. So the first version of it is actually two channel, based on 1310, 1310, and also 1550 nanometer. So that gives us the uplink and upstream and downstream communication, which we no longer rely on fiber pair, but just a single fiber that can accommodate a lot more communications. And two channels seems to be underused. So the industry managed to make a lot more development in that. So 40 channels. And of course, following that is the... Okay, following that will be the optical amplification and also digital coherent. So if you're familiar with phase shift keying, DBSK, QPSK, and so on, so those are the technology based on digital signal processing. So great development happened during that time that actually propelled the capacity of the fiber further and further. And today, we have DWDM, dense wavelength division multiplexing that can accommodate 160 wavelength. So that is a lot. So can we go further? So apparently not. When it comes to this line, which is 100 terabit per second, we are approaching the physical limit of single mode fiber. So we can no longer push more data into it. So that's where space division multiplexing comes in. How does it solve the problem? We have to use new fiber. We can no longer just rely on single mode fiber that has a very, very small core, about 10 micron. So on the left-hand side, we are looking at field mode fiber. So that is not very different from the single mode fiber that has a core at the center, but field mode fiber has a slightly larger core that can accommodate more than one mode. So I'm sure in your earlier lectures, you have learned about some of the vector mode. So in optical fiber, which is a weakly guided waveguide, where normally we use a linearly polarized mode, LP mode. So these are some of the modes. And in the market, there are several field mode fibers available, including 2-mode fiber, 4-mode fiber, 6-mode fiber, and so on. So on the right-hand side is another type of fiber, which is a little bit more complex and difficult to handle. That is one fiber, it has multiple single mode core. which is a lot difficult in terms of splicing and coupling with other devices. But anyway, I'll be focusing on film fiber. Okay, so that is not the only challenge. There are a lot more challenges. A new set of optical fiber components that serve similar purposes, just like their SMF counterpart, are required, such as coupler, circulator, isolator, film mode, FBG, polarizing maintained fiber, and so on, you name it. There are many of them. Why do we need them? Because to form a more complex network, we need all these components. And some of these components are lab prototypes, all right, but they are not commercially available due to some technical problem, or maybe the price. And in addition to that, we also need additional components for multiplexing and demultiplexing. In the case of SDM system, we call them fan-in and fan-out module, and also mode converter. So these are the two important things that we have to look into today. So how does multiplexing work in field mode fiber SDM system? Suppose we have four signals on four different SMF fiber, and we want to couple them, combine them, multiplex them, and launch into a single field mode fiber. How do we do it? So we have to perform mode conversion on three of them. All right, so three mode converters are required to convert the single mode beam, which is from LP01 to LP11, LP21, and also LP02. So if you are handling more modes, definitely you need more mode converter before we perform the fan-in, which is the multiplexing, and couple into field mode fiber. So mode converter is definitely one of the most important part, indispensable for a larger SDM network. So it is required because it enables interconnectivity between the modes. And these are the availables, some of the available mode converters in the market. And I would like to highlight a few. So for Tony Landon, it wasn't available at the time when I started the project, about 5 years ago. So it is now available. I'm not sure about the price though. But binary faceplate, it has been around for quite some time, probably talking about 15 years ago or 20 years. So it is widely available, and in fact, it's actually one of the most reliable mode converter in the market. It gives us a lot of usability and also control. Sorry. All right, and I'll be talking about field mode FBG. So this is the focus of my today's presentations. Field mode fiber break grading. So just like the common standard fiber break grading. So the fabrication is similar. The only thing different is just the raw fiber. So we are using field mode fiber instead. Hydrogenations to photosensitize the fiber before the grading excision using UV laser and also face mask. So ideally, LP mode in the field mode fiber, they do not couple with each other because they are autocorner, ideally. So meaning there shouldn't be any crosstalk. But the thing is, when we introduce refractive index perturbations, we bend the fiber, we taper it, we deform the fiber shapes, or we inscribe grading into it, FPG. So what happens is that we are actually promoting intermodal coupling. All right. So this is one of the pictures we take using microscope in my lab, grading inscribed in a film fiber. So these are some of the example spectrum, grading inscribed in a two mode fiber. And this is a four-mode fiber. So the parameters that differentiate them is actually the diameter of the core. So this is 90 micron for two-mode fiber and 25 micron diameter for four-mode fibers. So you're looking at a bunch of reflective wavelengths. Okay, so reason being because if you're dealing with single-mode fiber, you will be seeing just one wavelength. If you're dealing with two-mode fiber, you'll be seeing three wavelengths. So this one and this one are self-mode coupling. And the center one is a cross-mode coupling, which is enclosed by the dotted box, red dotted box. And if you're looking at four-mode fiber, because it's a lot more complex, so you look at the combinatory, choose two out of four, definitely you have a lot of combinations of cross-mode coupling wavelengths. So these wavelengths are the most important wavelength that we can use for mode conversions. So it's important to highlight this before I proceed further. All right, so in the previous slides, those spectrum were not excited in the professional manner. So we just do core offset, ladder offset for mode excitations. And we use faceplate in this case. So The red curve is the transmission spectrum under LP01 mode excitations. So instead of three wavelengths being excited, we see two only. So this is the LP01 self-mode coupling excitation wavelength, and this is the cross-mode coupling wavelength, cross-mode between LP01 and LP11 mode. And there is no self-mode coupling for LP11 because it's under LP01 excitation. So if you change the phase mask to LP11 mode excitation, so you'll be seeing the other two wavelengths, which is located here. All right, so this is self-mode coupling for LP11, the cross-mode coupling, and there's no reflectivity here. So it's important to understand the notation which I provide here because things will get a little bit messy later on when we form a more complex system. All right, so C refers to cross-mode. This is self-mode for 01 and self-mode for LP11. All right, so these resonant wavelengths are spatial mode dependent. So what happens if you launch a laser excited under 01 mode, LP01 mode, and to this wavelength? Basically, the laser beam will just go through the FPG without interacting with anything. They will just go straight through without being reflected. Same goes to if the laser beam is being excited under LP11 mode, and you launch it at this wavelength into film fiber, it will just go straight through. No interactions, no reflectivity. So perhaps some demonstration will be helpful. So this is the excitations and at this wavelength, under LP01 mode excitations. So this is how it looks like. So the beam goes into FBG, it's fully reflected, right? So as indicated by this reflectivity here, which is about 10 dB, equivalent to 90%, all right? So if we change the wavelength to this, as mentioned earlier, there shouldn't be any interaction, so beam will go straight through, and no reflectivity. So what happens if we launch the light to the cross-mode coupling wavelength? The beam will be converted to LP11 mode and reflected. Okay, so what can we do with that? So such a simple system, what can we do with that? Right, before I proceed further, I want to explain another thing. This is bidirectional. If we launch an LP11 mode into the film mode FPG at this wavelength, the beam will be converted back into LP01 and reflected. And it's very peculiar. It all can be explained using phase matching in the coupled mode theory. Right, I'm afraid I can't continue too much on that particular part. So basically, this table summarizes everything. All right. Okay, so we try to form a more complex system, optical delay line. So optical delay line is intended for elevating the contention issue in an optical network system. So if the network is too busy, we try not to launch the signal, the pulse into the network, the mode. So what happened? We send the signal into delay line. Just keep it for a while. When the network system is down, the traffic is lower, then we take the signal out of the delay line and goes into the system. So that's what it does. So right here, we try to form a rather simple system, which is based on two film mode FPG, FPGA and FPGB. In between, that is a very, very long film mode fiber. So in our case, we put a 500 meter long two mode fiber. So in fact, the entire fiber are of the same type. And the grading structures are also written based on the same phase mask, same wavelength, except that when we try to put them into the system, we have to align the wavelength. So we try to tune one of the FPG, shift the wavelength in such a way that I hope you can understand all this notation is going to get a bit more complex. So A refers to, these are the wavelength of FPGA, so these are the wavelengths of FPGB. So we try to align in such a way that lambda AC coincide with lambda B01. Why? Well, we're about to find out. So some illustrations. Animations make things easier. So if we launch the light, LP01 mode, at this wavelength into the system, what's going to happen? The beam will be reflected by FPGA, deny entry into the delay line. So basically, there's no delay. All right, so as simple as that. Configuration 2. If you launch the wavelength, I mean, it's the same light, LP01, but at this wavelength, and of course, it would You also argue that there's a little bit of reflectivity here. Just bear with me, that is not important, but I just want to know what happened to the remaining light that goes into the system. Yes, indeed, it goes into the system. Right, at least partially. And it's reflected by FPGB. Right, at this wavelength, which is self-mode coupling, LP01. Self-mode coupling, fully reflected. So the beam double pass the long film fiber, double pass. So there is a delay induced into the pulse. So configuration 3, we shift the wavelength to lambda A11, so which is a self-mode coupling of LP11 for FPGA. So what happened is you launch the light. So it doesn't interact with FPGA because that is the self-mode coupling of FPGA. All right. But it comes to this point, what happened is the beam will be converted and reflected. All right. So now the beam interacts with FPGA and reflected back and being converted again. All right. And then it goes out. So under this configuration, the beam interacts, it double passes the delay line twice. So higher delay being introduced. So, we did not consider that, but we are not using very high energy.
Can you repeat the question to the audience? The question.
I repeat the question about third order nonlinearity.
Yeah.
Okay, the question was, did I consider third order nonlinearity in the system? No, I did not. Because the fiber has a larger core, so if you look at the cross-sectional area, that is very big. So the intensity of the light is very low. So that is also one of the reasons why people want to go into SDM system using film fiber, because the nonlinear coefficient is lower. All right. And yeah, so the whole idea is that based on configuration 3, the beam will bounce between two FPG a couple of times. All right, it will be converted into different modes, LP01 and 11 mode, before it exits. So that's how we delay. We introduce the optical path distance for the beam that goes into a shorter fiber. So these are the results in the experiment. Oops, sorry. Yeah. So for configuration 1, there's no delay. So these are the values. Configuration 2, slightly higher, actually very high, 4.8 milliseconds for 500 meter long fiber. So it's double when it comes to configuration 3. So theoretically speaking, configurations 2 are supposed to be noisier, but we did not notice, we don't see any noise. There is a problem with our system. The reflectivity of a cross-mode coupling wavelength is not high enough to give us a 99% reflectivity in the current case due to the problem of our fabrications, but we managed to complete the test just to prove that there's a delay in the system. So what is the implication of that? We can delay the pulse. It's actually a lot more than that. We're trying to prove that film fiber can do a lot more. It can form a more complex system. Right? So imagine if you are dealing with film fiber amplifier. So you want the light to interact with the gain medium for a longer distance. So perhaps film FPG is one of the choice that you can actually form a delay line, but in the case we are trying to prolong the interaction length, increase the gain. Another more practical application would be film FPGs, they are actually mode dependent filter, right? So they band pass or band stop, they remove the beam, or you try to extract some of the modes out of your system. So the suppression ratio is actually more than 20 dB. So it depends on how long you want to make your grading. So most of the time we try to make 10 cm, we can make it 10 mm. Or we can make it 30 mm to make the reflectivity higher. Right, so I would like to thank my group members. So so the top five, they have already completed their degree, postgrad, graduate, and then they are everywhere. In one of them back to the country, the rest they are in other countries doing their postdoc. And I would like to highlight two person, that is Yanxian Li, who actually did part of the work, and also Anwar Zaini, who is almost finishing his thesis, going to submit for examinations. So he will be leaving soon. Yeah, and last, I would like to thank my director. Right, he's a distinguished professor. Professor Hari Thama, he's also the director of my center. So he's one of the academic icon in Malaysia in the field of photonics. Right. And my other work, so I won't be able to elaborate much. Looking at the time, I think I'm almost there. So if you find some of the color very attractive, you can ask the question later. All right. So this is about spatial mood splitter. And this is about faceplate. We tilt the faceplate to make the conversion efficiency more effective. All right. And so in this particular work, we make our faceplate. So although our center has a lot of facility, but we have a lot of limitation when it comes to assessing the grant. So there are times that we cannot, things that we can't buy. We have to make them ourselves, including the faceplate. And this is down conversion using just a film fiber angle facet system. So this is another work about this distributed temperature sensor, right? And to answer some of your question about where is the sensor work, so this is one of them. So it's actually micron resolutions, a distributed sensor based on chirp grading. So what happened is that we try to hang the chirp grading and we fire the CO2 laser on it. And in between, we try to put a mask to shape the beam into C. So that's what we get, right? And work has been published early this year. And this is my current work. We haven't really published anything, but it's about surface plasmon resonance in tilted fiber back grading. So this work, I'm currently working with one of the biochemists from Faculty of Medicine on disease detections. Yeah, I hope to report this result in the near future. All right. And I would like to end my presentation with a famous quote from a great scientist. And the creation of physics is the shared heritage of all mankind. East and West, North and South have equally participated in it. So there's no better occasion and place to say it in front of you, because I've seen many faces definitely from all over the world. And it is a quote from Professor Abdul Salam, the founder of ICPP. Thank you. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much for your excellent presentation. Questions?
I wonder how robust are these few-mode fibers, because my past experience, at least with multi-mode fiber, is that even a very small perturbation immediately causes transfer of energy from one mode to the other. I mean, and of course, if you want to use it for telecom, you want it to be very robust. So you mentioned crosstalk, but it's not clear for me how stable is this two perturbations.
Okay, the most important thing is that when you're dealing with few mode fiber, you have to make sure the excitation has to be very, very good. Make sure it is almost 99%. Let's say it's LP01 mode or LP21 mode. So you have to check, measure. There's no other mode exists in that particular fiber when you launch the light. So at the other end of the fiber, you have to measure. So once it's done, when you bend the fiber, the excitation of other modes due to the bending or twisting will be minimum. But of course, it depends on how much you deform the fiber. And in our tests, we encounter this kind of problem. This is probably one of the reasons why some engineer has some doubt on adopting this kind of technology. But if you're dealing with two-mode fiber, generally they are easier. Four modes are very difficult, right? And they are solutions to it. They have to make sure the effective index of all the modes are larger. So in that case, the coupling between modes will be lower, right? And another thing is, I'm still exploring because I have no access to some of these fiber, polarization maintaining few-mode fiber. So that is actually one way to prevent the intermodal coupling. All right. So most of the time, we don't really care about the mode. If you look at LP01 mode, so there are two beams, two loops. All right. So if you're using faceplate excitation, you can actually excite it in such a way, wherever you want, because it's purely mechanical. But if you excite it using just a normal method, other method, then you'll be getting a loop like this. So at the other end of the fiber, well, the output beam will be haywire. Yes. So that's why handling it has to be very, very careful, and it takes a bit of experience. So that is why in some of our work, we try not to, but sometimes we have no choice, but we have to put in a few more fiber to remove some of the noise, the beams in a higher order mode. So make sure there's only one mode exists in the fiber. So this is one way. And second thing, once we lay the fiber, we try not to disturb it too much, so to prevent the uncertainty of exciting other higher order modes.
Okay, thank you very much for the interesting talk and congratulations for the award. I'm just wondering about the insertion loss, the losses.
Insertion loss.
Regulating mode converters. Because it seems they are lossy. And
yes.
This is maybe significant for the communication network.
Okay. Like I mentioned earlier, one of the challenges is that there are many components that are still not available. For example, circulator. So the setup that I showed you earlier for the where are you? Yeah, this. So if you look at this setup,
this is actually a
replica or a replacement for circulator. Right. So definitely this system is very lossy. It's a free space optics. It's easy to control, but it's also very lossy. And another reason why we are doing this, because we want to put in binary faceplate, which is a piece of glass to put in between. So we need to allocate an ember space for us to adjust and do the alignment. So typically, binary faceplate will introduce 9 to 10 dB loss. 10 dB. So in a very fortunate occasion, maybe you can make it 9 dB. So that's the best we can do. So most of the time, you have to boost up the power to compensate the insertion loss of the system. So in case, but lately I've been reading a work about circulator, field mode circulator, developed by my previous collaborator from ORC, Southampton University. They have reported a work on a field mode circulator, but I'm not sure whether it has been commercialized. But if I were him, I would definitely file a patent and commercialize it. So because that would definitely solve many problems in an SDM system. So what we want to do is we want to reduce the insertion loss. So the current system, there is no loss here, very little loss here. But if you look at here, well, the loss is very high. But of course, most of the time, we spend a lot of time optimizing the system, minimizing the loss. There are times that we can't even see the spectrum because it's too lossy. Yeah. And I mentioned another thing would be the photonic lantern. So that is another way of achieving a coupling at a minimum loss, 1 dB only. Yeah, so this is another thing that you can consider if you want to go into this field. Yeah.
Other questions? Well, if not, I have one myself. Oh. How far do you think to be from, let's say, commercial exploitation of this method? And, well, I guess the major challenge is to reduce the losses,
yes.
were saying, when you combine the different components.
I'm very surprised to find that one of the report in 2014 or 2015, so field-mode fiber, three-mode fiber has been demonstrated for live feed communications. It's actually by one of the, I think, Huawei technology in USA. So, yeah, so they did it 5 years ago. So I think it will only take another 5 more years to complete other components. I think this thing will be ready to go.
System done.
Yes.
With
and
this,
because the transmission line is 20 km.
SDM, okay. So if there are no more questions, let's thank again the speaker and again congratulations. And I will give it back to Johnny Mela for final remarks.
Okay. Oh, thanks. Let me shake your congratulations. All right. I just want to make a few final remarks for this ceremony. By the way, I'm very happy that you showed Abdusalam's saying up there, because that's very important for us. And we talked about that a little bit more. And I'll talk to Anthony and some of our guests, because for the talks, It was very apparent 3 minutes after 3 minutes after 3 minutes. You saw everybody coming up from all over the world. You saw how we made a mistake on one of the poster, but you know, we could have mixed up all the titles, it didn't matter. And so that was really demonstrating that, and I thought sitting out there was really evident. You know, really, you saw the people. You don't just see the people out there, but you heard them, you heard them talking, it didn't really matter. And so we really celebrate that here, and so that's for that reason I want to really thank you. I want to make another remark. Okay, so we're going to have a reception tonight, and I think we're going to celebrate in your honor, and there will be some there'll be food, there'll be things to drink, and there'll be a live band. I think Vengu, did you make the announcement? Okay, the Entanglements have shown up, so we hired them, and they'll be playing tonight. So that's great, and we're going to celebrate. But before we do, I just want to say something serious, and I'm going to go a little bit off script here. Uh-oh, Sandra's getting worried. I'm going off script because the script is really small, and I can't find my glasses. It's empty, so I don't know where I put them. I know my hair's not parted right, but if I had my glasses, I could see that. All right, so I'm going to go off script. All right, so thanks for telling me about my hair. Actually, I don't have much of it left, so I appreciate it. You're making me feel younger. So what I wanted to say in regards to that, it's really wonderful that we're all here from all over the world. It really is. It's part of what ICDP is, as you saw. There's also something else that we have, and maybe that wasn't reflected in that saying, but we also have a gender gap, actually, in science. There's something that we really want that's very important for me. I know it's very important for many people here, and so we want to encourage more women getting into science. I think this one, if I didn't tell you before, there's 41% of female participation. That's a very good number. So what I want to just say to you is that for everything, for no matter what color we are or where we come from or what gender we are, we have to be a little bit careful about sensitivities because there are things that come through our culture. Maybe we make mistakes. Everybody here, most people, not everybody, but most of us are young, except for Vengu. We're all young people. You're all young people. Young people, you know, you can always make mistakes. It's not a matter, but it's, you know, what we have to do is help each other, right? So we're all in this. There's only one planet, and it's actually shrinking a lot. And with climate change, maybe we'll have to find a new one. But let's try to help each other, okay? It's a learning experience our whole life. But at any rate, let's go have a party and celebrate. I just wanted to tell you that. I think it's very important, and I'm proud of everyone. I really am. It's really great. Okay, let's party.